Hi viewers, welcome to Ashriya Vlogs and Crafts. Today we are going to listen to Sri Guru Charitra, Chapter 50. The Muslim King comes to see Sri Guru. We have seen a reference of a Raja in the 9th chapter. By the blessing of Sripad Sri Vallabha, he was born in a Muslim royal family and he became King of Bidar. Due to devotion of previous birth, he was kind and pious. He treated all religions and sects equally. There were several temples for which he had due sympathy. He also had respect for Brahmins. Muslim priests despised Brahmins and Vedic religion. But king said to them, God is one, only the names are different. All are created from five great elements, Panch, Mahabhut. The earth is the mother of all. Cows are different colors, but their milk is white. Ornaments may be many, but the goal is the same. Similarly, Paramatma, God, is everywhere, so make no difference between the religions and castes. Thus, the king was ruling impartially. Once he had a tumor on his thigh. Vidyas and Hakims treated him, but to no effect. The king had a great pain due to it. He called some Brahmins and requested them to suggest a remedy. The Brahmins said, sins of the previous birth harass one in the form of some disease. For this, visit holy places and give something in charity. Live in the company of saints. You go to the Paba Vinashi Tirth and bathe there. The tumor will subside. The king went to Paba Vinashi Tirth. He met a sannyasi there. He bowed to him and showed him his tumor. The sannyasi said, when you see a saint, you will be relieved of the disease. I shall tell you a tale in this connection. A Brahmin lived in Avanti, Ujjain. He gave up bath and Brahmin's rites, Santhya, Puja, etc. and lived with a prostitute named Pingala. Once Rishabha Muni came to them. They treated him well. They worshipped him and took the treat of his feet. When the Muni was asleep, both served him, keeping awake the whole night. Next morning, the Muni went away. Later on, in their old age, both the Brahmin and Pingala died. The Brahmin became the son of King Vajrabahu in the next birth. When he was in Sumanti's eldest womb, the younger queen became jealous and she gave a poison to the eldest queen, who got eruptions all over her body. She delivered a male child who was also affected by eruptions all over the body. The king got them treated by physicians, but they could not be cured. The king suspected that the infection would spread in the whole family and therefore asked a fisherman to take the queen and her son to the forest and leave them there. People were sorry to know about this evil act of the king. Sumati was roaming in the forest with her son in despair. Due to exertion, she was thirsty and was searching for water. She came to a mandir and met some females who told her, Padmakar is the king of this country. He is kind and pious. He will protect you. In the meantime, some maid servants of the king came there. Sumati narrated to them her sad account. They took Sumati to the palace and reported to the king about her. The king was very kind and he arranged for her to stay. Here too, the eruptions on the body of the mother and the son harassed them. One day, due to unbearable pain, the child expired. Sumanti began to weep bitterly. The ladies of the neighborhood tried to console her, but she continued mourning. In the meanwhile, Rishabha Muni came there. King Padmakar received him warmly. As he heard a mourning sound, he inquired. Padmakar narrated to him the sad account of Sumanti. Rishabha Muni came to her and began to console her, saying, it is futile to mourn for the bygone. All lives are like bubbles in the water. This body is made of five elements, and when these elements separate, nothing remains behind. So do not mourn for the perishable body. One has to suffer as per one's previous actions. For self-emancipation, to adore Sri Shankar, Sumati said, I had to come here leaving the kingdom and here too I met with this fate. Now I do not wish to live any longer. Saying so, she fell on the feet of the Muni. The Muni was moved to see her state. He remembered the service that a son had given him in the last birth. He applied a little bhasma to his forehead and put a little in the mouth. Suddenly the child got life and began to move. The eruptions on his body and his mother's body also vanished by the powerful sight of the Muni. Both looked as bright as gold. Sumati and the child bowed to the Muni devotedly. The Muni blessed them and went away. The greatness of the blessings of a saint is like this. If you serve a saint, you will be relieved from the tumor. The Muslim king asked with folded hands, "Kindly tell me where there is a saint. I shall go there." The sannyasi said, "Sri Guru lives at Ganagapur on the bank of Bhima. You go to him." The king immediately went to Ganagapur and inquired about Sri Guru. The people were afraid when they saw the Muslim king had come to Ganagapur. They did not speak due to fear. When the king asked again, he was told that Sri Guru had gone to the Sangam and he would return soon. Hearing this, the Muslim king started to go to the Sangam. On the way, he saw Sri Guru coming. He came down the palanquin and bowed to Sri Guru respectively. Sri Guru said, "O Raja, where have you been so far? I am seeing you after a long period." Hearing this, the Muslim king recollected his life of his last birth. He lay prostrate before Sri Guru and began to shed tears of love and joy. With choked voice, he asked, "Gurudev, why did you keep me away so long? Being entangled in the royal pleasures, I forgot you. Now I have come to your shelter. Liberate me. I am much harassed due to this tumor on my thigh." Sri Guru smiled and said, "Show me, where is the tumor?" The king began to look at his thigh, but no, the tumor had vanished. He said, "By your blessings, I could enjoy the royal pleasures and glory. All my desires are fulfilled. I now wish that you, Holy Self, should come to my palace and bless my family members." Sri Guru said, "We are sannyasis. We should not live in cities. You being Muslim, cows are slaughtered daily in your city. This is a great sin. Prohibit killing of cows in your kingdom." The king said, "I am not a king now. I am your devotee, a Raja. Give me a place at your feet." Sri Guru began thinking, "Now in this Kali Yuga, cruelty will be increasing. It will be better if I disappear from here." He therefore thought of going to Gautami, Godavari. While returning to the mat, the king seated Sri Guru in his palak and he took his paduka sandals in his hands and walked on feet behind palak. Sri Guru said, "You should ride a horse as you are a king. Your persons will blame you for serving a Brahmin and a sannyasi." The king said, "I may be a king for the people, but for you I am your devotee, a Raja. My body of iron is transformed into gold by your sight. All my desires are now fulfilled." By this time, all elephants, horses and soldiers of the king had reached the place. Sri Guru said, "Listen to me, ride a horse." The king first seated all the disciples of Sri Guru on the horses and then he rode a horse. And the procession started ceremoniously. Sri Guru then said to the king, "If he come with you, you cannot observe our rituals punctually. Therefore, I will go ahead. You come to Pabavishnashi to see me." Saying this, Sri Guru disappeared instantly with all his disciples and reached Bidar. Nagnath, the son of Shyamdev, met Sri Guru there. He worshipped Sri Guru and did Samardana. Then Sri Guru went to the Paba Vinashi Tirth. The Muslim king was very sorry to see the disappearance of Sri Guru from the procession suddenly, but he remembered that he was asked by Sri Guru to see him at Paba Vinashi. He rode a swift horse and started for Paba Vinashi. He covered the distance of 88 miles in a day. He saw Sri Guru and again requested him to grace his city by holy presence. The king decorated his city with flags, buntings and arches. He seated Sri Guru in a palak. 9 kinds of gems were waved on him. The citizens waved arati at various places. The Muslims censured the king for serving for the Brahmins, but the Hindu citizens and Brahmins praised him for liberal, learned and pious. The procession was going with musical instruments. Coins and clothes were being distributed to the poor. When the procession reached the main gate of palace, Sri Guru walked on the costly carpet spread over the path. Sri Guru was seated on the decorated throne, and all the queens and children of the king bowed to him respectfully. Sri Guru blessed the king and his family members and asked, Are all your desires fulfilled by now?" The king said, "I have fully enjoyed the royal glory. I now wish to serve at your feet." Sri Guru asked him to come to Sri Saila and went to Gautamani at Dashik. He bathed there and returned to Ganagapur. All the citizens were pleased to see that Sri Guru had come back safe. Sri Guru called all the disciples and said, "Now I wish to live secretly. Therefore, I intend to go to Sri Saila. Still, I shall be staying at Ganagapur. If I live fear openly, the Muslims will come here daily and trouble me for fulfillment of their desires, as the king himself has been there." The end. Please like, share, subscribe, and support. Thank you. Bye. Bye-bye, friends.